Let us rise and begin our worship by singing our opening hymn number 326 in the Green Hymnal, Rock of Ages.
Cast me not away from your presence.
and take not your Holy Spirit from me forever. Give me the joy of your saving help again, and sustain me with your bountiful Spirit. I shall teach your ways to the wicked, and sinners shall return to you. Deliver me from death, O God, and my tongue shall sing of your righteousness, O God of my salvation. Open my lips, O Lord, and my mouth shall proclaim your praise. Had you desired it, I would have offered sacrifice, but you take no delight in burnt offerings. The sacrifice of God is a troubled spirit, a broken and contrite heart, O God, you will not despise. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Brothers and sisters, God created us to experience joy in communion with Him, to love all humanity, and to live in harmony with all of creation. But sin separates us from God, our neighbors, and creation. And so we do not enjoy the life our Creator intended for us. Also by our sin, we grieve our Father, who does not desire us to come under his judgment, but to turn to him and live. As disciples of the Lord Jesus, we are called to struggle against everything that leads us from the love of God and neighbor. Repentance, fasting, and prayer, and works of love, the disciplines of Lent, help us to wage our spiritual warfare. I invite you, therefore, to commit yourselves to this struggle and to confess your sins, asking our Father for the strength to persevere in your Lenten disciplines. Most holy and merciful God, we confess to you and to one another, and before the whole communion of saints in heaven and on earth, that we have sinned by our own fault, in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done, and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart and mind and strength. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We have not forgiven others as we ourselves have been forgiven. Have mercy on us, O God. We have been deaf to your call to serve as Christ served us. We have not been true to the mind of Christ. We have grieved your Holy Spirit. Have mercy on us, O God. We confess to you, Lord, all our past unfaithfulness, the pride, hypocrisy, and impatience of our lives. We confess to you, Lord, our self-indulgent appetites and ways, and our exploitation of other people. We confess to you, Lord. Have mercy on us, O God. Our anger at our own frustration and our envy of those more fortunate than ourselves. We confess to you, Lord. Our intemperate love of worldly goods and comforts and our dishonesty in daily life and work. We confess to you, Lord. Our negligence in prayer and worship, and our failure to share the faith that is in us. We confess to you, Lord. Accept our repentance, Lord, for the wrongs that we have done, for our blindness to human need and suffering, and our indifference to the injustice and cruelty. Accept our repentance, Lord. For all false judgments, for uncharitable thoughts toward our neighbors, and for our prejudice and contempt toward those who differ from us. Accept our repentance, Lord. For our waste and pollution of your creation, and for our lack of concern for those who come after us, accept our repentance, Lord. Restore us, good Lord, and let your anger depart from us.
Hear us, Lord, for your mercy is great.
Amen. Accomplish in us, O God, the work of your salvation, that we may show forth your glory in the world. By the cross and passion of your Son, our Lord, bring us with all your saints to the joy of his resurrection. Almighty God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, does not desire the death of sinners, but rather that we may turn, that they may turn from their wickedness and live. Therefore, we implore him to grant us true repentance and his Holy Spirit, that those things may please him which we do this day, and that the rest of our life may be pure and holy, and that at the last we may come into his eternal joy, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray together the prayer of the day. Almighty and ever-living God, you hate nothing which you have made, and you forgive the sins of all who are penitent. Create in us new and honest hearts, so that truly repenting of our sins, we may receive from you, the God of all mercy, full pardon and forgiveness, through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated for the reading of the lessons. Our first lesson for this evening is from the book of the prophet Joel. Because of the coming day of the Lord, the prophet Joel calls the people to a community lament. The repentant community reminds God of his gracious character and asks God to spare the people, lest the nations doubt God's power to save. Our reading begins with verse 1. Blow the trumpet in Zion. Sound the alarm upon my holy mountain. Let all the inhabitants of the Lord tremble, for the day of the Lord is coming near, a day of darkness and gloom, a day of clouds and thick darkness. Yet even now, says the Lord, return to me with all your hearts, with fasting and with weeping and with mourning. Rend your hearts, not your clothing. Return to the Lord your God, for he is gracious and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love, and relents from punishing. Who knows whether he will turn and relent and leave a blessing behind him, a grain offering and a drink offering for the Lord your God. Blow the trumpet in Zion, sanctify a fast, call a solemn assembly, gather the people. Sanctify the congregation, assemble the aged, gather the children, even the infant at the breast. Let the bridegroom leave his room and the bride her canopy. Between the vestibule and the altar, let the priests, the ministers of the Lord, weep, and let them say, spare your people, O Lord, and do not make your heritage a mockery, a byword among the nations. Why should it be said among the peoples, where is their God? Here ends our first reading. Our second reading is from Paul's second letter to the Church of Corinth. The ministry of the gospel endures many challenges and hardships. Through this ministry, God's reconciling activity in the death of Christ reaches into the depths of our lives to bring us into a right relationship with God. In this way, God accepts us into the reality of divine salvation. Our reading begins with verse 20. Paul writes, we entreat you on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. For our sake he made him to be sin who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. As we work together with him, we urge you also not to accept the grace of God in vain. For he says, at an acceptable time I have listened to you, and on the day of salvation I have helped you. See, now is the acceptable time. See, now is the day of salvation. We are putting no obstacle in anyone's way so that no fault may be found with our ministry. But as servants of God, we commend ourselves in every way through great endurance in afflictions, hardships, calamities, beatings, imprisonments, riots, labors, sleepless nights, hunger. By purity, knowledge, patience, kindness, holiness of spirit, genuine love, truthful speech, and the power of God, with the weapons of righteousness for the right hand and for the left, in honor and in dishonor, in ill repute and in good repute. We are treated as impostors and yet are true, as unknown and yet are well known, as dying and see we are alive, as punished yet not killed, as sorrowful yet always rejoicing, as poor yet making many rich, as having nothing and yet possessing everything. Here ends our second reading. Please rise for the Lenten response. Jesus commends almsgiving, prayer, and fasting, but emphasizes that spiritual devotion must not be done for show. Our reading begins with verse 1. Jesus said to the disciples, "Beware of practicing your piety before others in order to be seen by them, for then you have no reward from your Father in heaven. So whenever you give alms, do not sound the trumpet before you as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and in the streets, so that they may be praised by others. Truly, I tell you, they have received their reward. But when you give alms, do not let your left hand know what your right hand is doing, so that your almsgiving may be done in secret. And your Father, who sees in secret, will reward you. And whenever you pray, do not be like the hypocrites, for they love to stand and pray in the synagogues and on the street corners, so that they may be seen by others. Truly, I tell you, they have received their reward. But whenever you pray, go into your room and shut the door. Pray to your Father who is in secret. And your Father who sees in secret will reward you. And whenever you fast, do not look dismal like the hypocrites, for they disfigure their faces so as to show others that they are fasting. Truly, I tell you, they have received their reward. But when you fast, put oil on your head and wash your face, so that your fasting may not be seen by others, but by your Father who is in secret. And your Father who sees in secret will reward you. Do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth where moth and rust consume and where thieves break in and steal. But store up for yourselves treasures in heaven where neither moth nor rust consume and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also." This is the gospel of our Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. You may be seated. Sisters and brothers in Christ, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Once again, we circle around to the great season of Lent. And we hear again that great phrase that echoes throughout the church on this night. Remember, you are dust, and to dust you shall return. Tonight we find mercy in the ashes. Remember, you are dust, and to dust you shall return. This is a phrase that rings throughout the Christian church on this day, as Christians the world over receive the sign of the cross in ash on their foreheads. This is not the only time we receive such a sign on our foreheads, but it is the only time that we do it visibly, and so can be seen by others. For many of us, if not most of us, the first time we were marked with this cross occurred at our baptism, where the pastor marked us with the sign of the cross and said, "We are sealed by the Holy Spirit." That cross and the cross with which we mark ourselves tonight are intimately connected. There is a direct line between the two. And each of us reminds us of the same thing, that we live beneath the power of the cross, that we have been claimed, that we have been named, and that we have been marked. And in that claiming, and in that naming, and in that marking, we are then called to live. But the lessons for tonight also raise a challenge for us and some questions. All of our lessons call us to take stock of not only ourselves and our piety, but also to ask ourselves these questions. Why are we here? Is the first question. Why are we here? Okay, and I know the thought that's going through the head of every confirmation kid in this room, we're here because Pastor said we had to be. Tell me I'm wrong. We are here because the Spirit has gathered in this community. We are here because we begin our deep dive into the story of God's love and salvation. We begin a deep dive into our story, and we look for our place in this story. Why do we do what we do on this night? That's the question that Christ asks us in the gospel, although he doesn't phrase it that. And there is a warning here. A warning that says we should not practice our piety as a matter of show or to demonstrate how good and faithful we are for others. But that what we do and what we practice on this night, and indeed in all of our lives, should flow from that center in which we live. Which is to say, all that we have and all that we are and all that we do should flow from the Spirit that has marked us and claimed us. As the Spirit moves us to faith, the Spirit also moves us to genuine repentance, so that we may receive God's forgiveness and God's mercy. And so we mark ourselves tonight and we say, "Remember, you are dust, and to dust you shall return." And in so doing, we are grafted into an ancient tradition that goes all the way back to the time of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, where God's people have marked themselves in such a way to remind themselves of where they stand before God. And also to remind ourselves that God is indeed merciful to those who are repentant. That is why we do what we do. To begin this season of preparation, to begin this season of introspection, by acknowledging exactly where we stand. And by saying, "We need you, O God." Our lessons for today also ask us this question: what matters most, visibility or invisibility? Because the movement of repentance to which this season directs us is ultimately what matters most. But we are caught in that tug between the individual and the community understanding of what that means. And we may mark ourselves with these ashes, so that others may see us and say, oh, well, there's a good Christian. And we may indeed like the individual nature of our faith, but we cannot forget or neglect the communal aspect. Because the truth is, both are important. One can reinforce the other. That's why the Spirit calls this community together. So that as we gather together to hear the story, as we gather together to share in the sacraments, and as we gather together in prayer, we can be nourished and sustained by the presence of our brothers and sisters. And we can support each other in our Lenten journey. Thus, we gather as a community because the act of worshiping together, of celebrating the Eucharist together, brings us into the flow of God's story of salvation. And in this gathering, we bear visible witness through the mark of the ashes, so not so that we can be seen by others, but as a tangible reminder of both our need for and the real presence of God's grace in our midst. And we approach this night, our worship and the sacrament, in that great paradox of simul justus et peccator, simultaneously saint and sinner. Sinful yet forgiven, remade by God's grace and yet not perfect on this side of heaven. We gather, and in this community we give voice through the psalm to that deep and constant prayer of ours. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew in me a right spirit, because I cannot do it on my own. We are drawn into God's presence to be shaped and molded by our outward signs with which we mark ourselves, in spite of the incongruity that this represents. But we also gather to be shaped and molded by our inward prayers and by the words of forgiveness spoken at this table. We are reshaped as we gather as a Spirit-filled community to bear witness together to the wonder of God's grace and the power of God's presence. Remember, you are dust, and to dust you shall return. Store up for yourselves treasures in heaven. Return to the Lord your God. Ultimately, today's readings recalibrate our sense of what is important in our religious practice and in our understanding of both ourselves and of God. And as we move into our Lenten season, we focus on fasting and prayer and giving. And we assess the question of to what end are we living out our faith practices? For whom are we doing these things? And what do we seek to gain? Remember, you are dust, and to dust you shall return. But also remember this. You are marked with the cross of Christ and sealed with the Holy Spirit. You are named and claimed, and you are loved. God has made us his people through our baptism into Christ, living together in trust and hope. We confess our faith using the words of the Nicene Creed. Together we confess. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Drawn close to the heart of God, we offer these our prayers for the church, for the world, and for all those who are in need. Renew your church, O God. When we have drifted from our call to proclaim repentance and to guide your people toward justice, lead us back to you. Encourage believers who hold the church's doors open for those who have felt excluded. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. Renew your creation, O God. Transformed parched places into watered gardens, and preserve every creature that awaits the arrival of spring. Turn each of us from practices of environmental exploitation to become responsible stewards of all that you have made. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. Restore our civic life, O Spirit of Wisdom. Teach those who are in authority to advocate for the liberation of all who are oppressed, and grant them courage to make the difficult decisions. Fill us with your wisdom and allow us to see in you, see in each other, a reflection of you in our midst. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. Renew our lives, O God, and spare your people from diseases of body, mind, or spirit. Send your healing to those who are overcome by illness or grief. Today we pray for Betty Coombs, for Elaine Seidels, for Cindy Pedersen, for Leroy Swalve, for Tyler Reinhardt, for Lanny Hansen, for Lon Tweet, for Carolyn Ritchie, for Bridget Johnson, Don Krokel, Bob Mortensen Jr., Phyllis Schroeder, Janice Campbell, Garwin Anderson, Connie Yonker, Lucille Anderson, and those we now name either aloud or in the silence of our hearts. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. Renew this congregation, O God. During these 40 days of Lent, confirm our sense of mission and expand our imagination for ministry. Deepen our faith, increase our love, and draw us into your unfolding work of healing and restoration. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. As we mark ashes on our foreheads, O God, we give you praise for all the saints who have died and yet are alive in you. Receive us with them into your eternal embrace and fill us with your hope. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. Accept these prayers we bring, O God, on behalf of the world in need. through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. You may be seated. As we enter into a time of communion, you will also receive the imposition of ashes on your forehead, if you wish. So you will come up, stop at the center station to receive your ashes from either Kristen or myself before you fan out along your table. And a reminder to serve yourself from the paper cup that is closest to you and the cup of wine or grape juice that is closest to the cup that you choose. Let us now speak the spoken liturgy that prepares us for communion. Accomplish in us, O God, the work of your salvation, that we may show forth your glory in our country. By the cross and passion of your Son, our Savior, bring us with all your saints to the joy of his resurrection. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us all our sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen us in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep us in eternal life. Amen. Let us pray together. Merciful God, we do not presume to come to this table trusting in our own righteousness, but in your abundant mercy. Grant us, therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat and drink the body and blood of your dear Son, Jesus Christ, that we may live in him and he in us, now and forever. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
It is indeed right and salutary that we should at all times and in all places offer thanks and praise to you, O Lord, Holy Father, through Christ our Lord. You bid your people cleanse their hearts and prepare with joy for the Paschal feast. Renew our zeal in faith and life, and bring us to that fullness of grace that belongs to the children of God. And so with the church on earth and the host of heaven, we praise your name and join with their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna, hosanna, hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. On the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread. He gave thanks and he broke it and he gave it to his disciples, saying, take this and eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me. And again after supper, he took the cup. And after giving thanks, he gave it for all to drink, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and hear us as we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world.
Have mercy on us.
Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world.
Have mercy on us.
Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world.
Grant us your peace.
You may come, for all is now ready. Would you please rise? May the body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace and peace. Let us pray. Merciful God, accompany us in our journey throughout these 40 days. Renew in us the gift of baptism, that we may provide for those who are poor, pray for those in need, fast from self-indulgence, and above all, that we may find our treasure in the life of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. May the blessing of God Almighty, the wisdom of the power of Christ Jesus, and the light of the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. And our closing hymn is found in This Far By Faith, number 69, Nothing But the Blood. Serve God, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. Thanks be to God.